saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice.
Eu sou tempo de agora. Furar um pouquinho ali no estado do ar. We want to ask that you might strengthen us one more time. And you might bless this congregation, that all who have come here may be blessed. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen. We have prayed for the gift of the Holy Spirit. It is something that the church has spent time asking for. And even in this meeting, have we prayed for the gift of the Holy Spirit? We want to ask, why does it seem like the gift of the Holy Spirit is not being fulfilled? We know that suddenly the people of God will have to receive that gift of the latter rain before they finish the work. It is what will give them power to finish the work. And so we ask ourselves, why is the gift of the Holy Spirit in them? We want to look at what the Bible says. Why was the gift of the Holy Spirit given in the first place? Let's look at the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1 verse number 8, and you could be able to go with me there if you could. Acts chapter 1 verse 8 says this. The Bible says, but you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the world. The early rain was given so that it would help the church of God, the apostolic church, to be witnesses. It came with the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And so what we see in the Bible is the early rain is given to prepare the disciples to preach the word of God. You understand that? The early rain is given to help the church to witness. You are able to see that now. And so that's why, after they received the early rain, we see them preaching the living word of God. So the early rain is given for the empowerment of the work of witnessing. Okay, now you could be able to see what the Bible says in the book of Ephesians chapter 4, really quickly, from verses number 11. So look unto what some of the gifts that God gave the apostles to help them in the ministry. The Bible says he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and some teachers. Why did God give these gifts to the church? You understand now? Why did God give these gifts to what? To the church. Verses number 12. For the perfecting of the saints. So we realize that the Holy Spirit was given for witnessing, But the gift of the Holy Spirit came with gifts. You understand what I'm talking about now? When they received the power of the Holy Spirit, they spoke in tongues. They did miracles. They healed the sick. They did quite a number of things. You understand? Now we ask the question, why were these gifts or talents given to the church? Were they given these talents to show off of the mighty works that they could do? Sometimes you have thought that God gives us the power of doing miracles so that we can be able to garner, I mean, what we call a supremacy for ourselves. You know what I'm talking about? So that I have the ability to heal diseases, and so God has given me that so that people may respect me as the only guy who can be able to touch guys and get healed. But when you study your Bible carefully, the Bible says that all those gifts were given for what? Perfecting of the saints. And then for the work of the ministry. For the edifying of the body of Christ. Verse number 13. Till we all come in unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. So the gifts of the Holy Spirit was given so that people would be perfected and brought to the full knowledge of Jesus Christ the Son of God. And to a perfect man. And to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So these gifts were given so that man could be developed to the measure of the stature, rather, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, to be grown up to the character of Christ. Verse number 14. That we henceforth, from the time that we have received this gift, henceforth be no more children. Tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Underline that. By every wind of doctrine. By the sleight of men and cunning craftiness. Verse 15. But speaking the truth in love, may we grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. So the early rain was given to the church, and it manifested itself through men receiving different gifts. These gifts were given for the perfection of the church. But then the Bible says that they were given these gifts that they should speak the truth in love. So the purpose of the gifts of the Holy Spirit was to speak the truth in love. So one of the reasons why the Holy Spirit has been hidden from coming to the people of God is because the people of God are not willing to preach that truth in the first place. We don't know what the truth is. And so if we do not know what the truth is, can God give us his spirit to empower us to teach error? So suddenly not, we cannot receive the Holy Spirit to propel error. You understand what's happening? Because God is giving His Spirit so that the witness can go to Jerusalem and all other parts of the world. What's the witness? The witness is that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. But we do not have the truth. So God cannot give us the Spirit to empower us to teach error. You understand what I'm talking about? So we can pray. We can spend time fasting. We can do everything, but the gift of the Holy Spirit will not be given to us. It is in that because we don't have the truth. And God cannot give us His power to propagate error. Okay, but now, I want us to look at this in a different way. This is what the Bible says in the book of Deuteronomy chapter number 11. Why did God hinder the rain from coming upon Israel? Deuteronomy chapter 11. Deuteronomy chapter 11. This will be interesting, but we are reading from verses number 16. Take heed to yourselves. Are you there, church? We need to be sure you are there. Take heed to yourself, that your heart be not deceived. And you turn aside and serve what? Did you read that?
Yes.
You take heed that your hearts be not deceived, that you do what? Turn aside and serve other gods and do what? And worship other gods. That's really huge. But then he says in verse 17, and the Lord's wrath be kindled against you. So what happens when you worship other gods? Talk to me, church. What happens when you worship other gods? God's wrath is kindled against us. You understand now? You understand what I'm talking about? But then it says, and he do what? Talk to me now. He shuts up the what? That there be no what? So when we turn against the true God and worship other gods, what does God do? Now talk to me, church. What does God do? He shuts up the heaven and there is no what? What do you understand by rain? The rain is the Holy Spirit. And so when we turn to other gods, God closes up heaven. And what happens? There is no rain. Now let me remind you of something that we need to understand. Because this is very important. In fact, let's continue reading again. And it says, and that the land yield not a fruit. So if there is no rain, do we have the fruit?
No.
There is no fruit. So if there is no Holy Spirit, do we have the fruits of the Holy Spirit? We cannot produce the fruits of the Holy Spirit. You understand? So if the church does not have the Holy Spirit, it means heaven has been shut. Why? Because they are in error. They have turned from the true God. They are worshipping other gods. And so, why was the early rain given? Witnessing what? The truth that Jesus is the Son of God. And that in witnessing this truth, they were to bring perfection in the church. You understand that? Until the church was to grow up to reproduce the character of Jesus Christ. The fruits of the Holy Spirit were to be perfectly revealed in the church. So, if God shut rain from coming down in Israel, there is no fruit. in the land. And so what follows, and the Bible says, and you perish. So those who don't have the latter rain, or those who don't receive the rain, do they have fruit? They don't have fruit. So what happens to them? They perish because Jesus says, I have come. I have been checking you a number of times, you understand? Jesus goes to the fig tree, and the fig tree is blossoming, but the fig tree does not have a fruit. You understand? What does Jesus say to that tree that is not producing fruit? Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the what? The ground. I have put manure. I have continually done all my work, but it's not producing garden work. Cut it down, because it's not producing fruit. So if the church does not receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, we must ask ourselves the question, why? The Bible tells us that the reason is because the church has turned away from the true God and the church is worshipping other strange gods. And so there is no yield, and the Bible says they quickly perish. And then I want us to now go to the book of 1 Kings, because the book of 1 Kings is where we'll be studying a lot. 1 Kings chapter 17. We'll be able to see a few things in 1 Kings chapter 17. I hope the whole church is in 1 Kings chapter 17 as we study together. 1 Kings chapter 17. And Elijah. We are talking about who? Elijah. You remember Elijah? Mm-hmm. This is the man who was able to say the king is naked. He did not fear the king. Every person, every prophet was a religious sycophant of the king. But Elijah said, no, it is not a Japanese suit. The king is naked. So Elijah the Tishbite was of the inhabitant of Gilead. And he said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall be no dew, no rain these years, but according to my word. So he appeared before the king and told king, no rain, no dew, for 3 good years, according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, get thee from hence. Let's look at that now. Elijah simply stated to the king, there's not going to be rain. Why is it that there is not going to be rain? It's a question that we need to ask, and we'll find in the scriptures. But God continues to speak to Elijah and tells Elijah, leave this place and turn eastwards. Now, question, who was directing Elijah? I'm trying to engage you because I know it's about lunchtime, and you should not just come to church to take a nap. So what's really happening is, who is directing Elijah? God. What has God told Elijah? God has told Elijah to tell the king there's not going to be rain. So Elijah is the representative of God. He's a voice in the wilderness. And Elijah is facing Ahab, the king of Israel. You understand? Now, God directs Elijah and tells Elijah, turn eastward, hide thyself by the brook Cherith that is before Jordan. Let's stop there. What has it mean by brook cherith? The word cherith, you didn't get it in local language. The word cherith, as is used from the Hebrew, means to cut. To search. Turn eastward and move to Brook Cherith. That is before Jordan. Elijah is told to turn eastward and do what to himself? Hide what? Hide himself. What happens when there is no rain in the land? Yes, true, that's true, there's no fruit, but what happens to Elijah? What does God want Elijah to do now that there is no rain? Hide yourself. And that's what we are looking at. One of the first things that Elijah must do is he must hide himself. What is the meaning of him hiding himself at Brook Cherith? What was Elijah going to do at Brook Cherith? He was going to hide, but the question should be asked, is he hiding because he's running from the wrath of the king? Certainly not. It is God who has told him to go and do what? Hide himself. Because Elijah needs a special time of prayer. I need to understand what I'm talking about. He needs a special time of prayer. Elijah needs a special time to study the word of God. He needs a special time to know why the people of God have gone down this route where God is closing the windows of heaven. What happens when we realize that God has closed the windows of heaven? God's people are to turn to their places of hiding. They are to remove themselves to places where they can spend time communing with God. The gift of the Holy Spirit comes as an answer to prayer. You can check it in the book of Zechariah chapter number 10. Ask ye the rain in the water. We are coming back there, but look at Zechariah chapter 10 really fast. Because that's what God says. What are we going to do when there is no rain? God says in the book of Zechariah, and that's chapter 10, and listen to what the Bible says in verse number 1. The Bible says, ask ye the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain, so that the Lord shall make bright clouds and give them showers to every one grass in the field. So Elijah is to spend time praying. Is to spend time laboring, asking God, studying the Bible, to know the cause of all this. You understand what I'm talking about now? That there is a place of prayer in God's plan to have his people receive the latter rain. But we are facing a chart that is prayer. Life is dead. A church that does not hide itself to pray. A church that does not spend time to know their standing with God. They do not go to a point where they examine themselves. So there is no time for self-examination. So God is calling us to run back to our closets. God is calling us to go again to our hiding places. How often do we pray? How often do we ask God to show us where we are? We are not seeing the promises of God being fulfilled in our lives. Yet, how often do we spend time in the hiding place at Brook Church? In fact, let's go back to chapter 17 of 1 Kings. That's where we're reading from. Okay, so the first thing is God to hide himself and pray. But then verse 4 says, and it shall be, verse 4, that thou shalt drink of the brook. And I've commanded the ravens to feed thee there. What's that to me? Who is feeding Elijah? God is feeding Elijah. Where is God feeding Elijah? At Brook Cherith. God is supplying Elijah with water, and God is supplying Elijah by having a raven supply his food. A raven? What's God teaching Elijah? Ravens are not known to give. Ravens are known to take. Or you people didn't study that in your biology. Ravens are not meant to give. Ravens are meant to take. But we are seeing God teaching Elijah a great lesson that is needful if at all the rain will have to come back. The servant of God must understand. Why is the rain withheld? The raven begins to feed Elijah. The raven should be taking. The raven is like the eagle. It should snatch the chicken from the hen. But no, the raven is now bringing food to the prophet. What has happened? A few things have changed. God is teaching the principle that is so huge to the prophet. God is teaching him that now he must begin seeing the principles that are in Isaiah chapter number 58. We studied this last. But that blessed is he that giveth than he that receiveth. That we have been born into this world for service. The true education is missionary training. All the children of God have been born to be missionary. And so what happens is we are told that the raven begins to feed him. But then the Bible says in verses number 6, and the raven brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank in the brook. Well, Christ said, if you eat my flesh every day, you've studied chapter number 6 of the book of John. Flesh, that if you have to have life in you, you must daily eat the flesh of food. And the same chapter talks about the bread, and Christ says, I am the bread of what? I am the bread of life. And then the Bible begins to show that the raven is to bring the word of life to this man, Elijah, and Elijah is to feast on the word of God. By the way, how many meals is Elijah taking at that time? How many meals? What's God trying to teach Elijah?
Temperance.
God is restoring temperance. He's telling him you can never be prepared to receive the rain while you are still on a diet that will actually exalt the lower passions. Are we going to finish the work if we do not accept health reform? I'm asking a question. Are you going to finish this work while you reject the health message? God is putting Elijah on a strict diet plan. 2 meals a day. Are you surprised to see that in the Bible? But yes, he's putting him on 2 meals in a day. And he's studying the word of God. And this is the same thing the disciples are doing in chapter number 1 of the book of Acts. What are the disciples doing? They are studying the word of God. They are removing differences. They are praying. Are we as a church studying the word of God? Are we as a church praying? Are we as a church removing differences? Are we learning what it means to be workers together with God? Well, if you're not doing these things, then that's what has hindered us from receiving. Why is the church dry as the hills of Gilboa? The song has been sung. Wapi roho ilioka moyoni mwa Ibrahim? Wapi yo roho ambao ulikuwa umeka ndani ya Ibrahim? Kadhalika ndugu Paulo hata naye Elia. Why is the church deficient of this power at the end of time? Well, let me tell you, the church has not learned to hide itself. We've not learned to be in secret chambers where we pray and study God's word. We sleep. We don't have morning hours for prayer, for meditation, and for study of God's word. How often in your home, my friend? How often in our homes do we have the silent hours of prayer? How often in our families do we gather our children for the morning and the evening devotion? In the morning and in the evening, Elijah was supplied with bread and he rejoiced in studying the word of God. Turn eastward. Go to Brook Cherith. There are certain things that we can't do in public. God always prepares his people to finish the work in seclusion. God prepares the people to finish his work in seclusion. In fact, if you look at Songs of Solomon, and this will interest you. Look at Songs of Solomon. I think it's chapter number 8. Songs of Solomon. Where does God prepare his church? Chapter 8. The Bible says in verses number 5. Who is this coming up from the wilderness? Leaning upon a beloved. I raised thee up under an apple tree. There thy mother brought thee forth. There she brought thee forth that bear thee.
Okay.
The church of God rises out of the wilderness. Where is Elijah? Is Elijah in the palace? Go talk to the church. Is Elijah in the palace? Where is Elijah? He is in the wilderness at Brook Cherith alone with God. Well, shout out to God. Where is Moses, my friend? Where is Moses when God is preparing Moses for a great work? Is Moses in the great cities of Egypt? Is Moses in the great universities of Egypt? Where is God raising and preparing Moses for a great work from? In the wilderness of Midian with sheep and goats. Out of the wilderness. And that's why God is saying, Elijah, you must turn eastward and go to Brook
Cherith.
God is directing him into a country living experience. God cannot finish the work through man whose dwelling place is in the crowded cities of this world. Where is Jesus Christ when God is about to begin using him? Where does God direct his son? Jesus is baptized. Jesus is baptized, and the Holy Spirit leads Jesus Christ to the city, isn't it? Where is Jesus Christ led?
Into the wilderness, my friend.
Jesus Christ is led into the wilderness to be prepared for a great work. How long did it take Jesus Christ? After the wilderness, it took Jesus Christ 3.5 years to do a great work. That's the power of wilderness experience. Turn eastward. Go to a place where I am the one going to feed. In the wilderness, we learn dependence on God. You understand what I'm talking about now? In the wilderness, we learn dependence on who?
On God.
On God. Was Elijah dependent on salary?
Yeah.
Talk to me, church. Was he dependent on salary? Was he dependent on his education? What was he dependent on? On God. We talked about faith here. The faith of Elijah was now in test. Elijah prayed so that daily he might have sufficient faith to keep him. And God says, I will spread a table before thee in the city. In the wilderness. You better understand where God is going to spread that table. You better understand where God is going to spread a table for his children. In fact, you need to understand why we don't have the Holy Spirit showering the church today. How many of God's people are having the wilderness experience today? How many of God's children are having that time alone with God? Time of prayer, time of study of God's word. How many of God's children are being taught the spirit of not just receiving, but the spirit of giving all they have to God? Elijah must turn eastward. And then the Bible says, and it's interesting for you to notice, we are still in 1 Kings chapter 17 for your information. The Bible says in verse 7, verses number 7, it says, and it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up. Because there had been no rain in the land. What happened to the brook? That's crazy. what will he do? The brook has just done what? Dried up. What's God trying to tell Elijah? Has God supplied you with some temporal blessings? Has God given you something that he has not given some other people? Has God given you some wealth? His servant must now learn not to put his trust in the prosperity of this world. You understand that now? God has given them blessings, and let me tell you, as a minister, God can bless your ministry. God can supply your wants. God can supply your needs. God can give you food for your family even without your presence. God can do great things to your family. But God can choose to let the brook dry. Because sometimes we can choose to look at the brook and forget the God who gives. Sometimes we can look at the gift and forget the giver of the gift. And God says, I will let the brook dry. I will let the brook dry so that I can teach my servant lesson of total dependence on me. Elijah is in the school of total dependence on God. Is in the school of trust and obey. For there is no other way to be up in Jesus Christ but to trust and obey. But listen carefully, friends, if you're reading your Bible, the word of the Lord came to Elijah and said unto Elijah, arise. Who is directing Elijah? Arise and go. Adventists, I want us to understand, if we are to finish the work, we must be led constantly by God. Arise and do what?
Okay.
Elijah is listening to the voice of God. And God is telling him, arise, get thee to which place?
Zarephath,
which belongeth to Sidon. And dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain. Wait. A widow? To sustain me? In a famine and drought? No. It doesn't make sense. Get thee to be sustained by a widow? I think God would have said, there is a rich man, Brother Zadok, that is going to supply for your needs. You know, there are sometimes when the servants of God think that God has to use some great men in the society to get the needs to God. You understand what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
They think that there must be some great man in the church to have this church fulfill its mission. Have you not seen churches thinking that way?
Yes.
Have you not thought of churches thinking about the rich men in the churches?
Yes.
And those men being appointed as elders and leaders?
Yes.
You've always seen this? No. Elijah is being directed to a widow of Zarephath. Turn to a widow. I am not sending you to a king. I am not sending you to a minister. I am not sending you to a cabinet secretary. I am sending you to a widow who will take care of you. We serve an amazing God. And you see, Elijah has learned to follow the voice of God. He didn't reason like we would have reasoned. Where will I sleep? The widow doesn't even have a house. And there has been no rain. Where will the widow get food? God sent Elijah to the widow of Zarephath. Now, let's think about that, friend. Do you understand what it means by Zarephath? That's not in Israel. That's not in Israel. Why a widow is out of Israel?
A
heathen woman. Why? Why? Haven't you seen the Bible says that there were very many widows in Israel?
It's only
the widow of Zarephath that God directed Elias to. Were there not many lepers in Israel, but that only Naaman the Syrian was directed to Elisha? Are Syrians Israelites? Certainly not. Why did God walk out of the nation he had chosen to choose a heathen? God is preparing Elijah that he might learn what it means to finish the work. Elijah is a type of end time Seventh Day Adventist who are going to finish. Are you getting what I'm talking about? Elijah is a type of men who are going to finish the work. They are to give the king a straight message as it comes from God. They don't care about the consequences. And so Elijah makes the message, it's not going to rain, my friend. They have a warning message to the world. They live in the country where they are able to warn men and women of the impending judgments of God upon the city. You know what? God could be sending them a woman. In the Bible, prophecy is like a church. You understand what I'm talking about? Now, this is like a church. But it's not in Israel. It's not in
Israel.
But now listen, in fact, let me read for you something. Listen to what Ellen White says in this beautiful book, and this book is called The Sour of Ages. In The Sour of Ages, listen to this, 238. Listen to what he says. Listen to this carefully. He says, in the days of Elijah, Israel had departed from God. What had happened? They had left God. They were in what is called apostasy. They had departed from who?
From God.
Then listen to what he says. It says they clung to their sins and rejected the warnings of the Spirit through the Lord's messengers. Thus, they cut themselves off from the channel by which God's blessing could come to them. Sikiza sasa mpendwa. The Lord passed by the homes of Israel. Are you thinking God cannot pass by your home and take a heathen Hello? God passed by Israel, the homes of Israel, and found refuge for his servant in a heathen land. With a woman who did not belong to the chosen people. Was it not a Samaritan woman that went and preached that Jesus Christ was a man who had revealed all our sin? Was a Samaritan woman? Was a Samaritan woman an Israelite? Was it not a centurion, a Roman leader, that said to Jesus, "Speak only a word"? Was it not a Syrophoenician woman, a Canaanite woman, who actually believed that she could even take crumbs from under the table of, eat with dogs? And so, my friends, you are seeing God who does not respect name. If pride lives in our heart, if self-sufficiency lives in us, if we blatantly disregard the God of heaven and His law, doesn't matter our position, God will bypass us. God will bypass us and use men who are lowly and yet living to all the light that He has shown
them.
In fact, you are told, but this woman was favored because she followed the light she had received. The light she had done what? And her heart was open to the greater light that God sent her through the prophet. And our hearts open to receive greater truths. And we walking in the light that we have received through this seminar. Well, if you know that God is going to bypass us, God will carry His messengers and take them to some heathen land. God may take them to those who you think are outcast and shall never see the kingdom of God. God shall lodge them and give them a shelter in the roof of a widow. So God says, go to Zarephath. And you know what happens, interestingly? The Bible says Elijah arose. And then in verses number 10, it says, he went. And when he came to the gate of the city, now listen, this is an interesting story. He beheld the widow woman was there, gathering stones. And he called to her and said, "Fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel, that I may drink." Excuse me. How long has it not rained? What God does this guy have to ask a widow for what? Our faith is going to be tested. Our faith is going to be tried. The Bible says, "Fetch me some water to drink." And as she was going to fetch it, and I praise God that this woman did not debate with that man. He did not say, "Hello, are you crazy?" He did not debate. He says, as she was going, in other words, at the word of the prophet. How many of us are like this woman today? These are the reasons why we don't have the rain yet.
Because
we don't have people. We don't have a church like this. When God talks to us about health message, do we believe it anymore? Do we believe it anymore? Do we believe the health message anymore? We don't believe the health message anymore. We debate with God, isn't it? We ask God, excuse me, where shall we get iron from? Excuse me, where shall we get vitamin B12 from? Excuse me, where shall we get protein from, isn't it? We question God. We question the prophet. We question the Bible. Now let me ask you. If a man is questioning God, where we'll get B12 from? Because it's not time, God is saying no flesh, isn't it? A question. How long did Adam live without B12? How long did Adam live without B12? Remember, you say B12 comes from animals. How long did Adam live without B12? 900 years. How long has your professor who told you you need B12 live? How long has your professor lived? How long has your doctor lived? Well, that's why God now says that only those who live not by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of who? Of God. And so this woman, which she had, she did not do what? Question.
But Elijah said,
if you pass the first test, what do you think of the second one? It's going to be a little bit strict. But Elijah says, but also, I pray you, bring me a morsel of bread in thine eye. And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel. Now listen carefully to what is being said there. In a cruse, and oil in a cruse. And behold, I'm gathering two sticks that I may go in to dress it for me and my son. And die. And Elijah said unto her, fear not. Go and do as thou hast said. But make me a little cake first and bring it unto me. And after, make thee and for thy son. What kind of a man comes to your home and tells you to cook for him first? For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse fail until that day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. What have you done with the little truths that God has given to you? What have you done with the graces of the Spirit that God has given you? Are your neighbors perishing without a knowledge of God? What have you done with the little bread and oil? That's the question. The widow is willing to surrender the little bread and oil to the prophet first.
Omo kungu oriya era nigara nge kurwa. Omo enda agre ya manama kuta ya makeigo.
Why do we have a problem in the church today?
Na asiki tu wate me chana.
Every talent that we have, we are holding it.
Kira ke hebu tu wate go tu.
Every truth that we have, we share it. No. We have them in our notebooks and that's the end of it. We have had those truths, we cannot share it with anyone. The beautiful books that you have, you've never been able to distribute them. And so for that reason, God says that he cannot bless the barrel. But unto the church, the widow church, that will be willing to supply the little resources. Perhaps they are just leaflets of books. They are willing to spread it. They might not be having much money. They might not organize a crusade. They might not do a great music concert, but because they are willing to surrender their simple resources to God, God says, there is no time you shall lack when you ask. And God continues to supply for them. Why is the church of God lacking? Because they have withheld the graces of the Spirit. Because the messages of truth preached to them, they have never shared with them. And the Bible says, as we end really fast, the Bible says this. We are in verse 15. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah. And a house did eat many days.
But
I want to jump to verses number 18. And verse number 18. Chapter number 18, rather. Verse 1, it says, and it came to pass after many days that the word of the Lord came. Step number 3. The word of the Lord came to Elijah in the 30th saying, now go and show yourself unto her. Many of us do not understand what that means. Elijah, go. Tell the king there won't be any rain. Elijah, turn eastward. Go to Brook Cherry. Spend time with God. Pray. Study the word of God. Have special communion with God. Elijah writes, go to the woman of Zan. For there, your faith will be severely tried. I want to develop character in you through the sufferings that you have to pass through. No food, no clothes. No temporal blessings. I want you to perfect your Christian character. Only then can you appear before Ahab. And so because you are now ready for work, show yourself before Ahab. Many of us are showing themselves before Ahab of this world without the necessary preparation. We are going before Ahabs of this world without the necessary steps in preparation. Let's have a crusade. What experience have we had communing with God and studying his word? I have had young men come to me, tell me, brother, we want to be missionaries. We want to work for God. And I ask them, do you know what you're talking about? When men see Elijah appearing before Ahab,
man,
they think that's a great privilege.
Before
you appear before the kings of this world, before you appear before the clergy of the church, before you appear before the elders of the church in the special truth for this time, have you spent time at Brook Cherith? Hello, church, you understand what I'm talking about now? Before you come to your husband, my dear sister, so that you can be able to share the truths that you've learned through the whole week, have you been at Brook Cherith to have communion with God? Have you spent time as God tried your faith and removed all the blessings and yet found you still faithful? As God dried the Brook Cherith and sent you to a widow and you followed by faith, then why are you appearing before her? Why are you going before her? I find men jumping in the streets and renouncing those men who have actually faltered the commandments of God. And that's well. But have you spent time at Brook Cherith? Why then do you go before her? God says, now stand. You are ready. Now rise. Young men, listen. Before God uses you. Listen, Brother Johnson. Before God uses you, you must spend time at Brook Cherith. You might walk without shoes in your leg. You might be renounced by your parents. You might go for days without food. Before God uses you. Before God sends you to declare an Elijah message to the world, we must have the experience of Elijah. Seventh-day Adventists, do you know why there is no rain? There is no one who is willing to go to Brook Cherith. There is no one at the drying of Brook Cherith that is willing to move now to the widow of Zarephath. God is saying, I want to send a missionary right now to Turkana. I say, God, you understand the situation. You understand. I just got a new job, and I missed for 2 weeks, so they're going to kick me out. You understand, God. God moves desperately. He says, I want someone to go to Somalia and teach the commandments of God. And he comes and says, my sister, please. My daughter, please go for me. I say, no. God, you understand that marriage is a holy and a honorable thing. I just got married to a beautiful Adventist. My Adventist. And God, you understand. Where are the men who are going to stand before Ahab? We love our education. We love our profession. We love the worldly prosperity. We love the things of this world. The work of God is languishing because no one in Adventism has the spirit of Elijah. Elijah is not there, and yet God says an Elias will come. Elijah represents the Seventh-day Adventist who will do everything for the sake of God, no matter what the cost is. They will only sing the song, "Where He leads me, I will go, for I have learned to trust Him." It may be the paths that I will be attacked by robbers, but where He leads me, I will go, for I have learned to trust Him. It may be the wrong way from my friends. I might have to part ways with my family, but I have the witness of Abraham. I have the witness of Ruth. I have the witness of Moses. I have the witness of Jesus Christ Himself. And so I can follow the blood-stained banner of Prince Emmanuel. Where are the men who are going before the world to stand before the kings of the
world
and tell the king that you are naked? There are men who have gone through Brook Cherith, and God has sent them to Sarepta, a widow. Go take care of a church. A church in Etago. A church without seats. A church without, the pompous buildings and everything. The missionary said, no, I want Maxwell in Nairobi, where they have office and cars. I can't go to a place. I can't go a place where people still sit on benches. You're sending me to a church that's a widow. It doesn't have anything. Well, God says, but I can never use you.
I have a thing. I think about me at
that. You have to be prepared for the work. You understand what I'm talking about now? Samuel, you understand what I'm talking about now? Because the sermon may be yours partly. You don't understand. That God is saying you cannot go to the field and claim that you... Now a man says, I need a computer in order to begin preaching. But for me to preach, I must have a computer like the one of Brother Sam. For me to preach, I need a microphone and another big mixer and a big PA system. For me to preach, I need salary. You understand what I'm talking about now? For me to preach, I need all these blessings. God is saying, go to a woman in
Zarephath.
The rain cannot come until the high servants of God have the spirit of Elijah.
And God says to Elijah,
my servant, now you're ready to appear before this man. And the Bible says, now show thyself unto Ahab, and I will send rain upon
thee.
Go now before Elijah. Before. Go and now preach that word. Show yourself before
him.
We need to understand what it means, my friend. Some of us have not had the experience that we need to have before we go before the world. Because the Bible says that I will give you power, you shall receive power. What was the reason for the power? That you may witness for me in Jerusalem and other parts of the world. But how can we witness before the world if we don't take the downward route to Brook
Cherith?
And so the church is dry. And so we continue singing. We continue singing Sabbath after Sabbath. Wapiro ilioka. Well, the problem is that we have not been to Brook Cherith. We have never learned temperance. We've never learned to feast on God's word. We have not studied God's word enough. You take a whole week, you have never opened your Bible. On Sabbath, you take your Bible and you just read. A young child found a Bible in the house. Asked Mommy, whose book is this? And Mommy said, this is God's book. And the child said, Mommy, take this book to God. It's doing nothing. Opening that book. How often do we study the Bible? How often do we pray in our home? How often do we meet as a church to pray for mission? How often, my friend? Now I want you to think about it. How often, my friend, do we spend time reaching out? How often do we visit the widows and the orphans and the less fortunate? How often do you have this experience? I ask you, young youths. I ask young boys and young girls. How often, my friend? How often do you study the word of God? Did you buy a Bible because it was a high school requirement? Is that why you bought your son a Bible? Is that the reason why you went with a Bible to school? Well, these are the people we expect to stand before the courts when the National Sunday Law has been passed. They will never be able to stand before us. But God says, for those who have gone to Brook Sherrick, God will say, now go show yourself. He is not fearful now. He's a courageous man. He appears before Ahab. And he tells him it will rain. It will rain. And you know what happens after that? You study your Bible very well. All the prophets, all the what? That were worshipping Baal. That they called a grand meeting on the top of Mount what? And right at Mount Carmel, there was a contest between the true God and the false God. And he said unto them, choose ye this day who you will worship. Choose ye what day?
Today.
Who you will worship. How long shall Israel halt between two opinions? If Baal be God, worship
him.
But if the only true God of heaven be God, then worship the only true
God.
Where are the men who can go with a straight testimony like that before the king? Where are the men who can come and say, no, this is not an Italian soup. This king is naked. The Lord God of heaven prepare his church. May give us the Elijah experience. The mission of Elijah is the mission of the remnant. That's our mission. That's our mission. Go ye to all the world. But how can we go except we are sent? Elijah was sent of God. And everything that God told Elijah, Elijah did it without question. We are called as he was called. Are we ready to surrender our lives?
kurubo ke mago ito.
Ano ba meta ko?
Ano ko lang? Ikaw baro ko lang.
This is very close.
O niya mga na igara yung gincho. Usama yung itangan.
Because we are living in the limit of this one issue.
O ano ko tomeya da sama tuko yung mga ano mga na
mga na. We don't have much time right now. God is desperately looking for those who are ready to do His
work.
And we need to make radical decisions for God.
And you are
saying that I want to surrender my life to God.
I want
to surrender my life to God. I want God to use me in a special way. You've spoken to us through the weeks.
But
now, I want to surrender my life to God to be used of God. Rededicate and recommit my life to God. I have never been to Brookshire. I have never been in that experience. I have never been there. But I have been swift to think I can go before the one. But I need this experience today. The
Lord
of men can never come. That is where every false god is cast down. That is where everything is made right. And that is what I want to do today. I want God to give me an experience. I don't know if there is such a person in this congregation who is saying, dear God,
I want
to have that Elijah experience. That's the person I want to pray with. And you know that I don't know how to make long calls. Just
as short as
I want that Elijah experience. So I mean, see, where he leads me, I will go, for I have learned to trust this. God needs such men today. God needs such women today. They can stand before anybody and declare the king. Want God to use you.
Only what I say,
we want to praise the Lord. Every step of faith made increases our strength. And I believe we are not standing so that the preacher may not be ashamed. But because we want to make a step of faith. We have to see ourselves conquering. And then we shall be conquerors. And so whatever you want the Lord to do for you, as we pray, just tell him. Our dear God, it may come a time we may say that the summer is past, and yet, Lord, we have not reached the stature of the man Jesus Christ. This is time we come before you, Lord, as even the rainfall is falling in seasons which and not it is right season. And we wonder what is happening in this world. It is a token and a symbol of what you want to do for thy church in a season when it doesn't expect it. We are gathered here that, Lord, we may receive the gift of thy Holy Spirit. And, Lord, we may arise. As you have said, you shall send Elijah. Indeed, you did it in the days of John the Baptist. And you can do it in this day and find some few Elijahs who will stand up and be able to stand before the kings and tell them thy word, which is true. Now, I do not know what thy children are praying for, but thou knowest the mind of everyone. If somebody is praying to overcome one thing or another, or a spiritual gift to be able to do thy work better, may you accord them today. And Lord, I being the least of them, I pray that I may not be a preacher and the end of the time be a castaway in my brother Zadok. We pray for the missionaries who shall be giving themselves and the elders and the Bible workers in this place, that you may especially give them strength to rise above the attitudes of men and discouragement so that they may be able to complete and finish their work. Thank you so much for the young ones and for the little ones who have been here for 2 weeks, Lord. Even if they didn't understand, Lord, let not the words we spoke escape from their hearts and from their lips. And when they have come to an understanding of them, Lord, let them have the courage to do them as Joshua even did to Israelites. Thank you so much for leading us this far. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.